I got there expecting to see the last.
Yeah, both boxes shut.
She had five to go.
I think there's nothing more embarrassing than a bunch of middle-aged old farts trying to recreate the halcyon days of Python humor.
I think it's probably best remembers for all the good work that we did and clamber up on stage and sort of crutches and with sort of medical support and try and do the sketches all over again.
Maybe in 3 years' time, the spirit will change and we'll all think we'll be dead soon, so we'll do, I don't know. But not in the foreseeable future.
We can't do both of those. Should we have music first?
I realised that we would never, ever agree on anything ever again.
Music first, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Monty Python, then we'll come on.
It is fun to be together. We do have a good time when we finally get together, but it's just such a nightmare getting everybody together that it's life's too short in the end.
So, 15 years ago, they were absolutely adamant that a reunion was completely out of the question. But they seem to have changed their minds.
And now for something completely different. News that comedy fans have been waiting a long time to hear.
Their parrot might still be dead, but Monty Python is hoping to rise from the dead.
Vi beklager å måtte avbryte denne reportasjen. Det nemlig tid for Monty Pythons gjenforening.
Monty Python have revealed their reunion plans.
I am a lumberjack and I'm okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Monty Python.
Hello, Polly! Polly!
Monty Python may well be the most successful comedy group of all time.
Nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition.
That's not what I mean. Say no more. Not what I mean.
Their surreal and very silly television show changed comedy forever.
We find that 9 out of 10 British housewives can't tell the difference between Whizzo butter and a dead crab.
Their films are still quoted in pubs and student common rooms the world over.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What? Judean People's Front. The People's Front of Judea.
We're Knights of the Round Table. They've even taken on Broadway and triumphed. Spamalot mania has spread to 21 countries worldwide. So it's small wonder the world is beside itself at news of a reunion. But there's a lot at stake here. They haven't performed on stage together for over 30 years, and they now have a combined age of 357. I'm not entirely sure they can pull this off.
And now you've announced this is the beginning of the end. Basically, you're not going to be on stage again, ever, ever, ever.
Everybody's over 70, some well over 70. The insurance is pretty high. In fact, the promoter, Phil McIntyre, said, oh, it's so much money to insure you guys. I said, well, why don't you just insure it so two of us have to die? And then if one of us dies, it's a tribute to them. So two have to die before we get our money back.
And on BBC One now, Ethel the Frog.
And now for something completely different. The comedy troupe Monty Python have been announcing more dates for their reunion show in London. That's after 20,000 tickets sold out in under a minute. And sail the wide accountancy to find. I just couldn't believe it. The phone rang. Well, it sold out in 45 seconds.
So we put five more on, and they sold out in an hour. Then they asked us to do five more, you know, so people said, yeah, okay. So then we got offers from all around the world, and Michael said no, as he was busy, he's doing a book tour. No, it's quite nice. So, well, having Michael say no meant that we only have 10 nights.
Welcome, world, welcome all! It's New Year's Eve!
Talk about how, you know, it's really exciting that you're back together and, you know, you haven't performed together for over 30 years.
Me and the Monty Python team are here!
Yes!
This is where you're going to come on from.
Yeah.
If you hit his head straight towards Graham, Graham and me and greet you and especially show your head.
They're about to perform together for the first time in over 30 years. Ladies and gentlemen, go NYE crazy for Monty Python!
Fun being with everybody, and there's so many good laughs, you know, even when we're just doing business or law, legal fees, we laugh a lot.
Mr. John Cleese is here! Hello!
The funny thing is, once we started to get together and work together, I suddenly remembered, oh, yes, we could never agree on anything, can we?
It's over 30 years, isn't it? It's 31 years or something since...
What is?
Since you performed. Since you performed in a live show together.
Yes, that was the Hollywood Bowl.
Yeah.
Absolutely, yes. So 40 years since we did it in England.
It's 33 years.
Yeah. All right, all right.
My God. Okay, can I just say, you mustn't fall out before the 1st of July. Hang on in there.
Walking down there was just like seeing the Beatles come in air. It's amazing to see you. Is there any chance I can get a picture with you?
We're meant to have a
picture. Show the Python pants, please.
Yes.
But not everyone is as convinced as Robbie Williams that this is a good idea. In fact, some people are just looking to start an argument.
Is this the right room for an argument?
I told you once.
No, you haven't.
Yes, I have.
When?
Just now.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
You didn't?
I did.
No, you didn't.
I'm telling you I did.
You must certainly did
not. One moment. Is this the five-minute argument or the full half hour?
Oh,
let me read you a commentary by the Daily Mail about the appearance of Python, the anticipation. From the bristling security beefcake, you would have thought it was a Madonna concert or the visit of a top-ranked politician. And like the vainest prima donnas, they arrived 20 minutes late. Eventually, this is even ruder. Are you ready for this?
Yes, go on.
Eventually, five slightly shriveled septuagenarians stepped from the wings to announce, to much fawning from camp followers.
That's right. They because it's the male, so it couldn't be genuine applause.
No.
No, it would have to be fawning applause.
Fawning. These ancients looked anything but sprightly. And they intend to cash in on baby boomer nostalgia by churning out some of their old hits.
It's interesting, isn't it? But what interests me is that the Daily Mail, which sees itself as sort of heart of middle-class Britain, people in Britain are very proud of their sense of humour. The Daily Mail has no sense of humour at all. And it's not as though we're child molesters, you know what I mean, or war criminals. We've made some people laugh. Not everybody likes Python. There's lots of people who don't like it, but quite a lot do.
Now, look. Thank you. Good morning. What? That's it. Good morning. I'm sorry. I'm not allowed to argue anymore. What? I wonder as
the bait. So where have they been for the last 30 years? Nothing. Really a life after Python has been, well, complicated. John Cleese, of course, made Fawlty Towers and A Fish Called Wanda. But in the last few years, he's been preoccupied fundraising with his one-man show, The Alimony Tour.
I was just doing it, you stupid woman. I just put it down to come here to be reminded by you to do what I'm already doing. I mean, what is the point of reminding me to do what I'm already doing? I mean, what is the bloody point? I'm doing it, aren't I?
As you might have guessed, he's got an expensive divorce to pay off. He's currently in Singapore, where we'll join him later. And what of the other Pythons? Michael Palin, You must remember him from those travel programs. Well, he's not doing those at the moment.
There's some commentary coming in a minute. Oh, here it is.
He's also got a tour coming up and a third volume of diaries to publicise. But where is he now? According to my sources, he's somewhere in the Yorkshire Dales filming a ghost story.
Yeah.
All right. What about Terry Gilliam, the oldest enfant terrible in show business? He's been busy making this, another dystopian sci-fi. But a man who feels happiest when surrounded by chaos and disaster is never going to be content spinning just one plate. Where's the fun in that? So he's decided to tackle one of the most difficult, rarely performed operas ever written. He's currently somewhere near the Olympic Park and can be heard tearing his hair out in rehearsals. Terry Jones. What of him? The last I saw of Terry, he was looking very much the twinkly-eyed history professor, slagging off the Renaissance and claiming Richard III was a genius.
It was quite astonishing.
Now he's dusted off his megaphone and is back in the director's chair for the first time in 18 years, making a comedy with Simon Pegg and Kate Beckinsale.
Everybody applauding! Oh, yes!
But in just a few months, these shriveled septuagenarians will be here. The O2 Arena. Over 10 nights, they'll perform to a total of 150,000 people, equivalent to the entire population of Slough. It's the biggest show of their lives, but nobody seems to care. And who's in charge? Ah, that would be Eric Idle. And where's Eric? Eric's at home in Hollywood, looking for a dear old friend he keeps locked away in a wooden box.
We are going down into the valley of the shadow of debt to look for the albatross, which is the prop that was originally used on Monty Python in 1969, and also I think it was came on tour with us. It's an albatross on a Nusherette's tray.
Albatross! Albatross! Albatross!
Two chalk horses, please.
I haven't got chalk horses! I only got the albatross!
I borrowed it in 2000. It was sent out here to California for me to go on tour with a show called Eric Idle Exploits Monty Python, which we went on tour with. And when I got it back, it had become an endangered species, and we were not allowed to send it or ship it back to England. So it has remained here in the lockup. I hope it's in the lockup, and we are going to see if we can get it out and then smuggle it back into the UK, and we don't get arrested for breaking the Endangered Species Act. But it is dead.
What flavour is it?
Or is it albatross, isn't it? It's not any bloody flavour. Albatross!
There's got to be some flavour. I mean, everything's
all right,
got flavour.
All right, it's bloody albatross flavour. Bleeding seabird, bleeding flavour. Albatross!
Personnel on this expedition is my son, Carey, who's in from Australia, and Alana, my assistant, my long-suffering assistant, is here. Is that the only light? What's this? Oh, look at that. Oh, nice. How about that? This is our first encounter with George Harrison. Me, George, Olivia, Terry Gilliam in Hollywood. So in here, there's all sorts of shite. Look, there's even a dead parrot cage. So but this, what is it? There you are. Life of Brian. Ran for 6 months in the West End, that did. It was closed by the Falklands War. I don't think there's anything you can say to that. I don't even know where it comes from. Well done. Hello, Alana. There it is! The albatross. My gosh. A bit ratty. I think the albatross is going to need a hairstyling. Albatross!
Look, it's on a tray. It's on its original tray, too, see?
You get wafers with it?
Of course you don't have fucking wafers with it, you cunt! It's a fucking albatross, isn't it?
Stop that. Stop that. It's filthy.
Bring out your dead. Bring out your dead birds.
The original Python team resisted a reunion for years, and when Graham Chapman died in 1989, it looked as though it would never happen. Now they're spread all over the world, all doing something completely different. Trying to organize a Python reunion is a bit like trying to get an octopus into a string bag. And since Eric is the man supposedly in charge, I wondered if he could shed some light on why they're doing it.
Did it come out of the blue, this reunion thing?
Well, we had just... we'd been involved with this idiot who was one of the producers on Holy Grail, and he spent 7 years suing us. So what it meant was it cost us £1 million to defend ourselves. So we were £1 million down, and people are getting old and ancient and decrepit. So we had to have a business meeting in August, and I was thinking to myself, we need some advice to tell us where we are. And I remembered my old friend Jim Beach.
Manager of Queen.
He's manager of Queen, but we were at Cambridge together. And he used to play the piano when I did cabaret with Graham Garden. But I've always known him and loved him. Anyway, so I thought, I'll ask him. And he, bless him, flew in from Switzerland and came to the meeting where we discussed all this loss. And, you know, I saw him for a drink the night before. I said, you know, if we did a night at O2, we'd pay this off in a second. And so in the meeting, Jim's listening to us. He said, this is such a mess. But, you know, he said, if you just did a night at O2, you could pay back all the money. And I laughed and I said, oh, that's a good idea. And everybody liked it. And they all said yes immediately. You know, suddenly we had a show.
I've got £90,000 in my pyjamas. I've got 40,000 French francs in my fridge.
The last time they performed was live at the Hollywood Bowl. They had a black backdrop, a few costume changes, and hardly any set. The O2 Arena is more than twice that size, a different beast entirely.
The thing I really thought, well, the only way we can fill O2 is if we have singing and dancing. So we've got to have a band. It's become sort of a musical with Python in the middle, which is kind of what I like. I think that'll, it sets it, and it won't be just like, you know, 5 70-year-olds trying to do a sketch show. It'll have a lot of energy of its own because of all these lovely young dancers and the songs and the music.
So, back in London, while auditions are underway to find the chorus line, across town, the Pythons get together for their very first read-through.
Who would have thought 40 years ago we'd all be sitting here doing Monty Python, eh?
Aye. Them days we were glad to have the price of a cup of tea.
Cup of cold tea?
Right.
Without milk or sugar.
Or tea.
For the first time in more than 20 years, Michael Palin is not making a travel show. He's heading the cast of a BBC drama. Remember Me is a supernatural thriller that's about as far from the silly antics of Python as you can imagine.
What is it? A vulnerable adult?
I'm told it's chilling, and that's not just the script.
Hello. Nothing comical about these. You really need them today. It's all right. I don't have any nude scenes or anything like that.
Palin plays Tom Parfitt, a frail old Yorkshireman, seemingly alone in the world, whose admittance to a nursing home triggers a series of inexplicable events.
I've got no family living. I'm Etihad.
Oh, back to your bag, I see.
Well, you've got to keep a bag packed. You never know when you might need it. But it certainly is nice to get something that is not adapted, completely fresh and new and and rather, you know, a ghost story in three parts. They don't really do that much nowadays. I fell down the stairs. I'm a what is it, a vulnerable adult.
I was going to ask you about how the read-through went.
The Python read-through? It went very well. I love going back and doing the material again. It's like the years rolled by. We kind of know the rhythm of all those sketches, arguments and things like that.
Sorry, the 5 minutes is up.
Well, that was never 5 minutes just now.
I'm afraid it was.
Oh, no, it wasn't.
It's like an old thing you've made years ago and you know how to work it, sort of thing. So it was like that.
That was never 5 minutes just now.
I told you, if you want me to go and argue, I'll have to pay for another 5 minutes.
I just paid.
No, you didn't.
I did.
No, you
did.
You never.
I don't want to argue about that.
Well, I'm very sorry, but you didn't pay.
If I didn't pay, why are you arguing?
When we all get together, which is fairly rare, things crackle along. And we had a very good time in November when the show was announced and all that. And we met up a lot. And once we're talking about performing and, you know, acting and working together to make people laugh, that seems to be fine. We're good at that.
And do these lions, by any chance,
yes, that's right.
Sorry, Mr. Frederick, what you got?
Someone's got to take a lead. You can't produce a show by email. Since Spamalot, Eric's been dealing with a big hit, you know, some big theatrical hit. So he's good at that, and he's got an appetite for it, and it seems to be what he really wants to do.
Manuel Kant was a real pissant who was very rarely stable. Heidegger was a boozy beggar who could think you under the table. David Hume could out-consume Schopenhauer and Hegel. And Wittgenstein was a beery swine who was just less sloshed than Schlegel.
You're not confused and learning your Python lines, are you? You probably haven't forgotten it.
Well, it's very good practice for the Yorkshire accent. You know, there's a lot of Python, or luxury, all the Python stuff we do, so there's some bone up on that.
There are 150 of us living in a shoebox in the middle of the road.
Cardboard box?
Aye, you were looking.
We lived for 3 months in a rolled-up newspaper in a septic tank.
I think I probably have forgotten the Python lines. I think I know them. We all think we know them, but we probably need prompting from the audience, which is why we're doing it in such a large venue.
You just have to get up every morning at 6 o'clock and clean the newspaper, go to work down the mill, 14 hours a day, week in, week out, for 6 months a week, and when we got home, our dad would thrash us to sleep with his belt.
Luxury.
Take one.
Getting into the mindset of something you're doing after this is almost impossible because this is totally, especially with this character, kind of takes you over, really. When this is finished, I can go back to being Michael Palin, which is a bit of a bore, really. You move into a place, you think it'll do me till Christmas. You don't expect to be stuck there the rest of your life.
How long have you lived in that house, Tom?
Oh, I forget now. I'm 80 odd.
Got that, please. Thank you.
Good. Acting under pressure. We did lots of Python filming up in Yorkshire, and those rocks up there remind me of the Cow and Calf Rocks near Ilkley, where we did the hermit sketch, which I loved, you know.
Hello. Are you a hermit by any chance?
Yes, that's right. Are you a hermit?
Yes, I certainly am.
Well, I never. What are you getting away from?
Oh, you know, the usual people chat gossip.
Oh, I certainly do. It was the same with me. I mean, there comes a time when you realise there's no good frittering your life away in idleness and trivial chit-chat. Where's your cave?
Oh, up the goat track, first on the left.
All of us in these strange outfits on top of the rocks. Are you yes, I'm a
While everybody else is busy, back in LA, the show is magically coming together by itself. Isn't it, Eric?
I'm fucking scared shitless. But I am, because I'm the only one who knows what we're trying to do. So it's like, but the others are blithely unaware. Like, I got an email from Gim saying, oh, he can't do the rehearsals because he's got to go to Paris to open his film. And you go, you know, the rehearsal thing? Hello.
Hello.
I can hear you all right.
Sorry, Eric, you go first.
Everybody should really have a look at the fifth draft. I've already tried on the Argent Provocateur underwear just to make sure it's safe for comedy.
Thank you.
Now, the naked organist is cut.
Okay.
Who's going to make sure that that happens?
Excellent.
Wait, wait, stop. You will not get the pythons to wear them. Need, yes, get, no. No matter how many times you say it, it doesn't.
Understood, yeah, okay.
I don't think that's a good idea. I'm sorry, I still didn't get who's going to make sure that happens.
Sensibly humiliated. Perfect.
Because I'm also losing Terry Gilliam. He just announced he's opening his fucking film in Paris.
So he can't come to rehearsal.
So we could maybe get Marty Scorsese.
All right, I'll give him a ring.
Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye. I mean, the two that I'm looking forward to most are, and we've never done these sketches live before, is John as an Elk, which I really love. I have a theory and what it is too.
Your new theory. Oh, what is my theory? Yeah. Oh, what is my theory that it is? Well, Chris, you may well ask me, what is my theory?
And Terry's never done this, which is the Spam Cafe before, and so we're recreating the Spam Cafe because now we have 20 people who can be Vikings singing spam, 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 lovely spam. So we'll do all of that live.
I don't like spam!
Spam, 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 spam,
spam, spam, spam, spam, spam, spam, spam,
morning.
Eric has assembled a crack team to look after the song and dance numbers. Longtime musical collaborator John Dupre is a relative spring chicken at 68.
It could even build out like that, you know. Oh, that would be nice. Because you have this sort of, it goes... You know, you sort of build up, you know, coming from the. So you have, oh, yes, yeah. I can do all of that.
Well, you know, just.
Yeah. And marshalling the dancers is the high kicking and renowned choreographer, Arlene Phillips.
A big circle around in between the tables, up and over the tables.
Mm-hmm. Arlene Phillips is so great. She is the spirit of it all. She was the choreographer for The Meaning of Life. So she's really cool, come back into it.
Our opening routine, which is about penises, vaginas, bottoms, I decided to look at the signing for all the words that you could use to describe them and try to put them into choreography. You can notice them if you're aware of sign language, otherwise you just think we're making beautiful arm movements and lovely gestures.
Like 6,000 miles away in Singapore, John is about to perform his one-man show for the 200th time. Oh, and he's writing an autobiography in longhand.
I'm not kidding you that I have spent 8 months out of the last 10 months of my life in hotel rooms. So it's very apt that we should be talking here in a hotel room, but this is often my reward.
I've seen very, very little work of any of the other pythons, and it's exactly the same the other way around. It's funny, we don't pay a great deal of attention to each other's work, by and large. It's quite true, you know. Everyone's gone off in completely different directions, but the nice thing is when we get back together, we laugh a lot.
It's not a bad theater.
Thinking about them a bit for the purpose of the autobiography, I was beginning to realize I don't understand any of them at all. I used to think I understood Palin, but I don't.
And I've never been able to understand either of the two terriers, what's going on in their mind. I think I sort of vaguely know what Eric likes, because Eric very much enjoys, loves show business, you know what I mean? And I can understand that.
A bit on the nose and a bit there on my enormous chin. There, made up for another show now.
Ten minutes,
John. Ten minutes.
All right. Okay.
See you soon.
Bye. Or phone, or iPad, or even using a fax machine is strictly prohibited. So please, welcome to the stage a man who needs no introduction. Here he is, John Cleese.
Well, the main reason that I have to do this, of course, is to pay the alimony. I think people know that. But I'm reaching the point now when I would have nearly have paid it off.
I have so far paid my latest ex-wife $22 million. Yes, 22, and I have another million to go. But I have to tell you, my Californian lawyer tells me that I got off lightly. Oh, yes, he said, think how much more you would have had to pay her had she contributed anything to the relationship. Years to come, a certain poor student of media studies will be required to write an essay on what that means.
Oh, sketches that I'm excited about doing. Done. I should probably enjoy doing them, but I don't get excited about doing stuff, particularly if it's 130 years old, you know. The one thing I'm glad I don't have to do is a silly walk sketch, which I never thought was as funny as everyone else did. And I pointed out to Terry Jones, I think it was his idea, that the only reason it became so iconic was the brilliance of my performance, you know? Because I never thought it was a very good sketch. It was just a funny idea.
Good morning, I'm sorry to have kept you waiting, but I'm afraid my walk has become rather silly over this morning, so it takes me longer to get to the office.
When I did that on stage, there was so much laughter just because I was throwing my legs around, which I could do before I'd had them all replaced by surgery. When I was throwing them around, there was so much noise. I would be saying to Michael Palin on stage, I said, I know you wrote this, but it's not a very good bit of material. I mean, they're only laughing at the movements I make.
But last year, the government spent less on silly walks than it did on industrial reorganisation. We're supposed to get £348 million a year to cover our entire silly walks programme.
In the absence of Cleese's legs, Arlene is going to put the silly walks to music.
Round. Do you know what I mean?
Whatever we're doing, we are being John Cleese. Yeah. So we're not being, you know, it's all the time keeping that focus, keeping his body, keeping the way he moves in our
So literally when
minds,
we do that, the yeah. poster lean about, okay, everything yeah. should stand.
There, down there, so really, and then you push off.
Before I wrote the script, I went to everybody and asked them what they would particularly like to do. So, and some were interesting, because John asked for a really weird one called Gumby Brain Surgeon. And he's doing that. And it's hilarious, you know, it's only an obscure TV sketch.
Doctor!
We need a big door, and it's got to be anchored securely, because you just knock on it, and then he's going to enter backwards, smashing through it. So this is quite tricky, because yeah. you know, the whole thing fall over. And on the same truck is a prop desk, which he smashes and will fall to bits.
Are you the brain specialist?
these sets. I mean, when they originally came up with it, you know, they gave us this, a rather ugly modern box, you know what I mean? And so I said, no, 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 you've got to make it Gilliam. And so he came back with this. And now we know where we are. You know, in the Python Billy Gilliam world, it's much nicer for these nice warm curtains and drapes that move open to reveal the Gilliam world of animation.
Terry Gilliam, the Python's animator, has gone on to forge a hugely successful career as a film director. His singular visual style can be seen in Time Bandits, 12 Monkeys, and perhaps his masterpiece, Brazil. Earlier this year, he released The Zero Theorem. Made in a matter of weeks on a modest budget, Terry was characteristically candid about it at a private screening.
It is what it is. There are moments of humor. There are moments of sadness. There are moments of tedium. They're all in a film, a complete motion picture.
All right, Quinn, how's it hanging?
It's Colin, Mr. Jovi. And as we've told you before, it isn't hanging at all well. We're dying.
I mean, always when you do the first cut of a movie, it's a great disappointment. That's standard. This was something deeper, something more utterly tragic. And I said, burn it, just burn this thing. It doesn't work, it's a mess. I blew it.
Despite Terry's early neuroses, he recut it and salvaged a film which was favourably received. And now he's applying his unique talents to opera. Benvenuto Cellini, by the French composer Berlioz, is a notoriously difficult and rarely performed piece, perfect for a man who loves a challenge.
Singing to all these guys, hail, artists, and you guys, all of us together, yeah, brothers at arms here, let's go. Get in
there. Is there actually lots of humor in Berlioz?
Humor, yeah. There is now. I think in this one he was trying to be funny. There's certain scenes that are very comic opera, like he just goes on too long. Once again to the stomach. Yeah, yeah. The foot goes back as if to kick. Yeah. Once again to the stomach. He's right down your throat, man. Mm-hmm.
Do you have a sort of fellow feeling with sort of Cellini and Berlioz as well, for that matter?
I've never even bothered to read biography of Berlioz. I'm not interested. The music tells me the creative process is what he's writing about. The torture, the beauty of it, the horrible experience, which I can identify with. And that's exactly Cellini's story, the only Renaissance artist to write an autobiography. It's wonderful. It's so outrageous because he's a liar, a bullshitter, and yet he created these most extraordinarily beautiful things. And I find that very interesting. I would like to create things as beautiful as they do. I end up just making jokes about things to cover up the fact I've failed.
Terry is being self-deprecating here. His previous attempt at directing opera, The Damnation of Faust, was a rip-roaring success.
We did something, and it's a big we that pulled it off. And that kind of made me want to come back, drag some more people into it, because when it's good, opera's pretty amazing.
His co-director, then as now, was Leah Hausman.
I listened to this opera and I really thought, why? Why? Why does he want to do this? Why would you do this opera? It's absolutely convoluted and difficult and doesn't make sense and the plot goes all over the place. Why do I care about this guy Cellini? And that's the first thing I said to Terry, and he went, yeah, it's kind of a problem. He then went, why did I choose this opera?
Drunk falls off his table, yeah. His chair. boom.
Oh.
So here we are, and you're 2 months away from the big day at the O2. So I'm wondering how much that's on your mind, how much you're thinking of your compatriots.
Very little is what I thought. I mean, I've had to do things like I found myself back designing the poster for it. Oh, we're re-releasing albums. Oh, a new box. Oh, we need a cover for that. So I've been doing my old job, basically. And I'm trying not to think about the rest of it because I've got much less to do than they do. In fact, I'm almost at times embarrassed because Eric has added more parts trying to keep me in the midst of it. I don't really care. I mean, I just go there. I don't want to have to spend a lot of time thinking about it. It'll be great, 17,000 people on their feet cheering. That's very good for the ego. And then after a few nights of that, I can go home and get through the rest of my life.
I've got two legs from my hips to the ground, and when I lift them, they walk around, and when I lift them, they climb the stairs, and when I shave them, they ain't got hell.
Are you looking forward to being on that stage?
I don't know. I mean, I've got the problem because we're one short at the moment. I've got to do things like Gumby flower arranging, which Michael does brilliantly. And to step into Mike's shoes scares the shit out of me, quite frankly.
Good evening! First, take a bunch of flowers. Pretty begonias, irises, freesias, and chrysanthemums. Then, arrange them nicely in a vase. Oh, get in! Get in! Get in!
Mike is a genius, and we all keep saying, stop this traveling business, come back to comedy. He is, to me, the funniest of all of us.
Can be hit. People can be hit. Looks very heavy, but actually it's just, I guess, balsa wood. I've got a lot of pies, and I think the best way to make pies is shaving cream.
Yeah.
They need to be brought on in paper plates, so that when you pie something, the plate falls off, but it doesn't smash their noses.
And where's the fun in that? Trust me. Yeah.
And now the foul pie.
And he just goes like that to her. So she gets the pie. That's the physical tag, blackout. Da 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 da. Curtains in, da 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 da. Clearly the intermission.
Brilliant.
Right?
There will now be a medium sized intermission.
Busy as ever, Eric is now back in LA, reversioning that most classic of Python sing-alongs.
When you're in the World Cup and all your hopes are up, been a long time since the year, I know, you know.
You know Terry is in the midst.
I know, for his second year now.
Yeah, have you heard from him about how it's going?
He always says it's a disaster. So I said, you know, he said it's chaos. I said, you like chaos. If it's not there, you create it.
This is true.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And always look on the bright side of life. Cheer up.
Okay, thank you.
Next time.
As the lies you tell your kids, confessions at bbc.co.uk. We're talking Python with Michael Palin in just a moment. Rebecca's got doubly...
In London, Michael has kindly made room in his busy schedule to plug the Python show on Simon Mayo.
To do something in July. So, you know, if we can give them other things which they can get...
Back in Los Angeles, Eric can't resist listening in, hoping to hear some recognition for his contribution.
And do you find it quite exciting?
Yeah. Well, I'm glad that we've decided to lay this one to rest, you know. Are we going to get together again? Oh, no, sorry, we'll leave it 10 years. Suddenly it all happened this time, and everyone said yes, and there we are. And it's quite terrifying, really, to be out there. Sure. And,
you know, that is terrifying.
But I think it'll be fun. I think it'll be great.
Yes, really. It will.
Who is the one, if you're all deciding what to do, who's the one who would say, no, I can't do it? Who is the one who was always saying no?
Me. Seeing as you ask, that's not entirely true. But when, because I've got this volume of diaries coming out, I don't want to plug that.
Another yet, one.
There's 10 years. It's 88 to 98, and the last bit is actually about Python at Aspen Festival in Colorado. Went along. We were given an award.
I think Eric is a little put out because there has been no mention yet of all his hard work.
Michael Palin is here because he's got something to say, and this is it.
The very last night of the Pythons, the last Python show ever, is going to take place on the 20th of July, 2014.
I think I know who's doing all the work.
Yeah, he doesn't get mentioned yet. No.
Have you thought about rehearsals
or not? Yeah, I've thought about it, yes, and rejected the idea. We're just going to turn up. Eric particularly is putting together a production, so there'll be dancing, there'll be songs, because basically all of us are playing about 10 different roles or more in the show, and that means you've got to go off and change.
Then what is it that you're looking forward to the most afterwards, apart from a long holiday?
Oh, it'll be a sad decline. I shall just sit there and play the old sketches and cry a bit. No, I've got volume of diaries coming out, as I said, 1988 to 98, called Traveling to Work. So I shall be...
touring England.
Instead
of Australia.
Life after Python, I hope.
Michael Palin, a pleasure as ever. Thank you very much.
Thanks. I'm great.
He hasn't even got to 2000 yet. That was very good, Michael. You did very well.
He did well, didn't he?
Yeah. I kind of think of you as the sort of head boy, because you are the head boy of this venture. That's for sure.
Yes, but in Python, there's always somebody has to take responsibility. That's how we do it. If you're doing an album, somebody's going to take the responsibility of producing it. If you're doing a movie, somebody's going to direct it and look after all of the boring shit that makes it possible for us to be good when we do it.
We're knights of the round table, we dance where we're able. We do routines, we call the scenes, we put work in bed cable. We dine well here in Camelot, we...
So, for this production, Eric is in charge, but it hasn't always been that way. For their film, Monty Python and the Holy Grail, directing duties were shared between the two Terrys, Gilliam and Jones.
Well, it's a dog's body job, actually, directing. I think it really has just got to organise things and work out what you're doing in the morning, and it's a very thankless task.
We're really learning as we do it. That's what's nice. We've been given a whole feature film to learn how to make films. Or...
But, I mean, you're all treating them with proper respect.
Well... I mean, there's never been any mutual respect within the Python group at all, as you probably know, but we're withholding a lot of the criticism that we would normally be making.
On Life of Brian, Gilliam switched to the art department, leaving Terry Jones in sole charge of directing, which meant he could save the funniest line for himself.
Now, you listen here! He's not the Messiah! He's a very naughty boy! Now go away!
The last film Terry Jones made was The Wind in the Willows, but that was in 1996.
Toad. This is Mole.
Just going to send for you, both of you.
My young friend's just lost his home. Has he? What a stroke of luck!
No.
And now, 18 years later, he's back in the saddle, making a sci-fi comedy with Kate Beckinsale and Simon Pegg.
Stop filming me!
No, I'm kidding.
So why the long wait?
You know, I kind of gave up on making feature films when Wind in the Willows was so badly distributed.
Well, what happened then exactly?
My producer rang up and said, it's on in New York.
In Times Square,
yeah. So I went round and it was on a little porno cinema which had Wind in the Willows on it.
Raising expectations.
Yeah. and I went off to get a camera because I didn't have a camera on me at the time. And I came back and it was off.
Within the time you went?
Yeah. And it was, according to the San Francisco Chronicle, it was the second best reviewed film of the year. And it just tears me apart, you know, the waste of it.
Roll camera.
Rolling. Stand by. And the scene today is right for the beginning of the film, is that right?
Yeah, it's a dream sequence. Neil dreams that he's got a successful book that's won the Man Booker Prize, and he's dreams about his love, Kate Beckinsale.
Now, with the publication of this brilliant novel, reviewers agree he's entered the ranks of Britain's immortals. Ladies and gentlemen, Neil Clark.
And Dennis the dog barks in the film, and an avalanche of dogs coming down that staircase there. And the dogs take over the dream, really.
I devoted 5 long years to capturing it in a book, which I hoped would throw open the doors of human perception and allow us to be engulfed in a sense of our own futility.
God. That's very good. Great.
You've got the O2 shows coming up. 150,000 people are coming to see you. How are you preparing yourself, Terry?
Staying up late, drinking a lot.
Who's doing all the work then?
Well, Eric's doing the work. He's directing the show, and I'm glad he is. Yeah.
Okay.
The dancers, I may say, are wearing agent provocateur underwear.
So, that's exciting.
Yes. This is Neil submerged in a sea of dogs.
I just assume I'm going to get tickets because I'm working with Terry, and at some point down the line when we're sitting by the camera, I'm going to sort of, you know, try and black some off him. But I've said, how's it all going? And he just sort of goes, oh, yeah. I don't think he... It feels to me like nobody knows. I don't know if they've spoken to each other recently or that there's any plans. They've just decided they're going to do it, and it'll probably just happen on the night. So, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if Graham materialised.
Are there any sketches which you're looking forward to or want to be in the compilation? Are there any favourites that you have?
I'd like to hear Terry do the crunchy frog again.
What sort of frog? A dead frog.
That chocolate box list of ingredients is fantastic.
What, a raw frog? We use only the finest baby frogs, dew-picked and flown from Iraq, cleansed in the finest quality spring water, lightly killed and then sealed in a succulent Swiss quintuple smooth triple cream milk chocolate envelope and lovingly frosted with glucose.
This is Maybeard, still a frog. Oh, what else?
That's great, yeah.
Brilliant.
Brilliant, okay, great.
Happy?
Happy, yes.
Thank God for that.
Camp it up! Ooh, get her loose! scratch your eyes out. Don't come to bring your fingers with us, dear. We all know where you've been, you military fairy. Don't look now, girls, make no
the girls is the same as the boys. We love this. This is our favourite drill, the penis drill.
Ooh, sounds painful. Across town from Terry's movie set, Arlene is busy putting the dancers through their paces.
If you just do that, doesn't look like anything. You've got to really push to see that the fans are fluttering.
What are you planning to do when you get there to this?
Oh, well, it'll just be, I'll just be charming.
Oh.
I shall press the charming switch, and I shall come out and be absolutely charming.
John Cleese has come home, as you can see, and we're on our way to promote his book. However, he has insisted, charmingly, that we divert and go home first to visit his cats.
Dawdling.
All right, come on.
Yes. Dixie. Where's the other two? This is the biggest one.
Wow, he is a big boy. Is it a boy or a girl?
Boy.
And what's his name, this one?
Felix. Uh-huh. And I call him Felix. He's so amazing. Oh, he's got this one.
This is a small one.
Ah.
Isn't he wonderful?
Yeah. Yes. His face is just like a tabby.
Exactly.
Yeah,
he's like
exactly.
A ninja, isn't he?
And they're absolute brothers. I mean, they're born exactly the same time.
Yeah.
And we were going to just buy this one, weren't we? And then Fish said, there's a brother.
Look at Fish.
We
so
both
cool.
said, ridiculous, wasn't it? We just said,
yeah.
Okay.
Oh, Heaven's got the blue eyes.
Oh, my God, we've got three.
Yeah.
And this one's called Heaven.
Yeah.
He is unbelievably beautiful, isn't he? Exactly. I'm an anachronism, but I'm perfectly happy with that because yes. I don't particularly like the era that we live in at the moment. It doesn't seem to be a terribly intelligent or terribly creative one. So I'm only slowly stumbling in the direction of most technology. I mean, I use email. I think that's very useful.
He's good on Twitter. He's got 3 million followers.
So why Twitter?
Because I understand Twitter, which is that some people wish to receive occasional silly messages from me. And I do that because, as Stephen Fry pointed out, if you've got lots of people following you on Twitter, you don't have to do interviews with treacherous British newspapers.
3 million followers, I have to say, I'm quite impressed. How long have you been doing it for?
I've
been Twittering myself for about 2 years.
What about twerking? What's twerking?
Twerking is different.
What Prince Harry does?
Yes, twerking is different.
Twerking is doing my dance, Jay. When I do my dance?
Oh, yes.
That's twerking.
That's twerking.
Mr. Cleese, welcome.
Thank you.
In the publishing world, John Cleese's autobiography is the hottest non-fiction title of the year. Of course, it is a work in progress.
Are you enjoying writing?
Yes, and I found a way into writing because once you get into it, it's almost difficult to stop. Because you get so involved with it, it's like this crossword that you can't figure out. You just don't want to let it go.
Now, I'm really interested that you appear to be writing your autobiography in longhand.
Yes, I know. It's the most natural thing in the world for me. And I write about 300 words a page.
Nothing crossed out, I notice.
Ah.
Rubber.
Rubber. And I will do quite a lot of this. I'll sometimes rewrite a sentence 3 or 4 times.
How's your memory?
Better than I thought. You suddenly remember, oh, yeah, I remember saying that. And then that will spark off another memory. And it gives you a kind of an overview of your life. You know, you tend to look at your life in little chunks, and you begin to piece the whole thing together again and to kind of recover it.
I remember filming in particular. I always found strangely dissatisfied. I could do quite a good day's work in front of the camera, but when I went home afterwards, I didn't feel I'd done anything of substance. Whereas if I sat down with a few sheets of paper and wrote a 3-minute sketch, then at the end of the day, I had created something, and that seemed to be satisfactory in a way that acting wasn't.
Well, what's on the television then?
Looks like a penguin.
No, I didn't mean what's on the television set. I meant what program?
John Cleese's writing partner was the late Graham Chapman. Together, they created some of Python's most memorable comic moments.
Funny, that penguin being there, isn't it?
You must miss Graham. I'm sure you miss Graham.
Yeah, I miss Graham, yes. Yeah. We used to really laugh at the same things, and we had, in some ways, very similar minds, and others completely different.
I wish to make it complete. Sorry, we're closing for lunch. Never mind that, my lad. I wish to complain about this parrot that I purchased not half an hour ago from this very boutique.
Oh, yes, the Norwegian Blue. What's wrong with it?
I'll tell you what's wrong with it. It's dead. That's what's wrong with it.
The parrot sketch, that was the two of you, wasn't it?
Yes, we did. Thanks to Monsieur Roger.
So how did that happen?
I discovered this book. I mean, I was at Cambridge, I think, and I discovered it. And it still gives me more fun than any other book I've ever read.
It's pining.
It's not pining. It's passed on. This parrot is no more. It has ceased to be. It's expired and gone to meet its maker. This is a late parrot.
And I would spend a lot of time choosing the word sometime, and then we'd hear how popular the show was in Japan, and we thought, what are we bothering for?
I'm not prepared to pursue my line of inquiry any further, as I think this is getting too silly.
Quite agree. Silly. Right, get on with it. Get on with it!
Graham Chapman, co-author of the parrot sketch, is no more. He has ceased to be. Bereft of life, he rests in peace.
Please have Graham together with the best comedy writers of their era. You know, their sketches would just sparkle. You know, it was just solid laughs.
I could hear him whispering in my ear last night as I was writing this, "All right, please," he was saying, "you're very proud of being the very first person ever to say shit on British television. If this service is really for me, just for starters, I want you to become the first person ever at a British memorial service to say fuck."
Of course, there is one person missing in every room, and that's Graham.
Graham always was missing, dear Graham. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm a bit late. Traffic. One of the things I always felt was a drawback when we were discussing the Python reunions sort of 15 years ago. Did someone come in and play Graham in the sketches? How do we do it? And because Python was very much six people writing and performing, it's like a six-legged table. You take away one, it's all going to wobble a bit. Things have changed so much that we can now use sort of little grabs of Graham and tips and put them on the screen and just bring him in, I think, as we're going to at certain points, saying, "Very silly, that's enough."
Oh, well, bye for now, Frank. Must trouble.
Right, you two hermits, stop that sketch. I think it's silly.
What?
It's silly.
What do you mean he can't stop it? It's on film.
That doesn't make any difference to the viewer at home, does it? Come on, get out. Come on, I'll call you.
So I'm looking forward to that. I'm really looking forward to that. It would be very touching, really, because, you know, Sandy's not around for it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's truly a real honorable experience to be here this evening.
I see for all of you. It's Christmas in heaven. And so he starts it on screen.
It's Christmas in heaven. All the children sing.
But then we'll bring on all our girls in those rather naughty titty costumes that we use in The Meaning of Life.
Yes.
And the boys will be in white tuxes. And we'll have snow.
But it's nice and warm and everyone looks smart and wears a tie.
This is our finale.
Yeah.
So we're going to get it going really disco. We've gone live with the band.
And we got the audience to join in and it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger.
We use this as our playoff music, they know it's the end, okay?
Yes, it's another book launch. Bear with us. I think it's Michael's. Yes, that's Michael.
Sorry, I just had to stop. I've just seen John Cleese's autobiography advertised. There it is. It's called So Anyway. I wonder when that's coming out. We could be touring at the same time. We could both be in Northampton. You very rarely get a python congratulating another python about thing that they've done outside Python. I mean, when John talks about my travel programs, he always goes, you know, Michael, are you going to do any more of the travel programs?
He's away travelling. He's doing one of Michael's travel programs. Have you ever seen Michael's travel? Oh, very relaxing, aren't they?
You know, we all sort of have a go, and I say, oh, John, you know, who's writing your autobiography this year, you know, and that sort of thing. Of course, we emulate each other. We're sort of seeing what other people do. You can't just stop and say, well, I can do that, and I can do something even better. Oh, I'm far more popular.
It's opening night for Terry's opera. In this morning's Guardian, there's a diary piece which is pretty damning about the production, describing it as a complete mess. The author, Terry Gilliam. Enough said. Still, when I find him, he seems on pretty good form.
Backstage is a miracle place. Every day, miracles are performed. Impossible situations are made possible. Thanks to them. They can't afford proper clothes, but...
How are you feeling?
I'm fine. I'm just numb. I just want to go to bed. I'm not even sure if I want to sit around for the show.
Finally, after 2 years of planning and months of rehearsals, the moment of truth. Is it any good? The answer is a resounding yes. Five-star reviews will follow tomorrow. But tonight belongs to Terry Gilliam, the eternal wayward child. Not just a python, not just a film director. An old dog who just can't stop learning new tricks.
I'm a complete novice in this business, but it was partly trying to learn a new job, and we're continuing it. I don't know where it leads, but it's a completely different process of making films, that's all. And so as you reach the final act of your life, it's nice to see and try something new.
Do you feel old?
It's one of the reasons I like working with young people. They're a mirror. I must be about their age. Oh, 27? Oh, yeah, I feel like 27. Now, what it is, I think it's the basic manic depressive ride that I'm on. So, I mean, Maggie, my wife, knows just how miserable I am and how... But then something happens and we start playing and it's off again. Maybe it's not too late to learn to juggle. I just need to keep enough going to get to the end and then I can fall over dead.
It's no good. I just can't go on. I don't get anymore. I want to end it all. Goodbye. Goodbye.
I don't feel as though I'm any older, mentally or even physically, than I was when we did the Python shows. And of course I look in the mirror and I am very old. What I think was going to be one of the most difficult things is the quick changes. You know, when you're over 70, there's no quick way to get your trousers on and off. I haven't actually practiced taking my trousers on and off quickly. Would that I had that sort of life. But I think the Velcro will be the order of the day. I think this could be, you know, the Python's Velcro night. And, you know, we might all die by the end of it. Or enduring it.
I am dead.
Yes, well, the thing is, we've got some people from America for dinner tonight.
Who is it, darling?
It's a Mr. Death or something. He's come about the reaping. I don't think we need any at the moment.
Hello. But do leave him hanging around outside, darling. Ask him in.
Oh, come on, Sammy. Good luck to us.
Lads gathered.
Here's Michael. He's
oh,
here.
The lads
are
gathered.
Yeah,
get my hat.
I think one more song before we go. As it's serious.
All right.
My time's almost done. My course almost run. I stand at the edge of that shore. I feel the tide mocking my pride. I'd like to hide, but what for? We all get a while to sing and to smile, but life has just one fatal flaw. When our course is run, we all fade from the sun. When all's said and done, say no more, no more.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, gents. Have a good show.
Okay.
Hey, we're ready.
Yeah.
If you've enjoyed this record, you may be interested to know that there is an exhibition of old sketches at Sir Henry Irving's birthplace, where you can also see the lady with the big knockers in the Jam commercial. You know, the, well, oh, what's a name? Oh, who that? What do you call it?